This is your Illini Drive.
Joey Gelman, host, Chicago, Illinois.
Dan Collins, co-host, Chicago, Illinois.
Kevin McCarthy, social media man, Geneva, Illinois.
Jeff Omer, producer, Naperville, Illinois.
Line to Morgan. Out top, Coleman lands. Rice is for three. And he got it. Illinois ends an 11-0 run. Coleman lands with a three. Illinois up 58-48. Minnesota with the ball. Another steal. Murphy lost it to Hill. Hill to Nunn. To Hill for the layup. Pattern and he's fouled. Jumper along with three. Banged it off the glass. Not even near the rim.
Oh, great play.
Pretty feed to Morgan, who slams it in. Illinois will close out the home schedule with a win over Minnesota. 84-71, the final for Illinois.
Welcome into Illini Drive, your home on the way home for Illini Sports every Monday at 6. Joey Gelman alongside Jeff Omer, Dan Collins, Kevin McCarthy. UPTV is here. They re-air us every Wednesday at 9 p.m. on Urbana Public Television. You just heard the highlights from last night's winner for Illinois in men's basketball. Took down Minnesota in the home season finale. I like Shake It Off as the bump there. You're shaking off the rust and ugliness that is this Illinois season. Follow us on Twitter at @DI_sports and at the Daily Illini. At Illini Drive is also show's Twitter handle. Going to start out with a little basketball talk, 6:15. We're switching gears to hockey. Eric Cruickshank and Austin Zima of Illini Hockey will be joining us. They're going to preview their tourney game coming up this weekend. Alex Roux, men's basketball columnist, is going to join us at 6:40. He's going to break down the Illinois basketball game a little more for us, what it means going forward, and the commitment of four-star guard recruit DaMonte Williams, son of former Illini great Frank Williams. So we'll start here, and I apologize if it sounds like we're trying to shift gears a lot today in terms of delay in response. We're down to two microphones, unfortunately. A couple of them decided to die out on Friday, as maybe you were listening and heard the sportscast. I tried to ask a question to our guest, Dan Hayes, and unfortunately, nothing appeared to have come out of my mouth because the microphones didn't work. So we're down to two, but two is better than none, so we will stick with that. Hi, guys. How are you doing?
And then there were two.
I feel like I gave like a huge Oscar monologue, and now I need, but I didn't make as good of jokes as Chris Rock last night.
Happy Leap Day! How many times can you say you broadcast a radio show on a February 29th? I've noticed Dan Collins does not operate well on leap days. Spilled coffee on myself, woke up late, showered a little too long, running to class. I've just been all over the place today. But I did get a fantastic compliment today. Guess what actor I look like.
This is going to be a lie, but go.
Somebody at Dunkin' Donuts, the lady behind the counter. I go to this Dunkin' Donuts, the one on Green Street, quite often. She told me I look like Tony Stark.
I don't even know who that is.
Iron Man. That's what I told her.
I'm Googling a picture.
Yeah, Google Tony Stark. I told her, you mean Tony Stark as in Iron Man or Tony Stark as in Robert Downey Jr.? And she said, no, like Iron Man. I was like, no, my goatee is not nearly as fresh to death as that. And she goes, no, just the demeanor and your attitude. She's like, it's very Tony Stark-ish. And then she didn't give me my coffee for free, but I walked out and I was like, you know what? You just made my morning. Look at that handsome man.
Other than a really bad goatee, I think
she's onto
something. The comparison is off. Nah, I'm just going to say the bad goatee's about it.
I thought I was Tony Stark-ish.
Anyway, well,
you're a man.
Here's what I'll say about leap day, leap year, whatever. All I know is that the Daily Illini, what is he covering now? Women's basketball? Matt Gertzmeyer, he told me there's no rules on leap day. No rules whatsoever.
Yeah, is that like an inside thing or something? I got a Snapchat earlier. It was Michael Dwojek, our good old buddy, old pal here. He Snapchatted a certain area of his house. He said, no rules today.
Yeah, so there's no rules.
Yeah. Why?
Because it's leap day.
Is it almost like Purge? Like you do a Purge on leap day?
Yeah, sure. You can do whatever you want.
I never saw the movie The Purge, but is that when they did The Purge? Was it on like a leap day?
No.
Is it on February 29th?
I don't think it has anything. I think you're just missing the point. I don't think it has anything to do with anything. Okay. It's just leap day. You can do what you want. It's kind of like when it's your birthday. You can tell people whatever you want to tell.
Yeah, it's true.
They have to do it for you.
Do you really feel bad for the people who are born today? Not really, right?
Yeah, because if you're our year or my year, you're a sophomore, then you've only had five birthdays.
Yeah.
That sucks.
So you're 5 years old.
You're 5 years old.
You're walking into campus bars legally. Yeah. Look at that. Yeah. The way this America, what a great place to be in.
Yeah, what a time to be alive. Yes.
It's just, I can't imagine having something important as your birthday only 4 years or 5 years. Like, that's no fun. Like, you have, like, a faux celebration, like, if it's a wedding anniversary or a birthday.
But if you're a parent, you're just like, oh, we hit the jackpot. Like, I'd just be telling the kid, like, no, I'm sorry, I won't give you gifts unless it's actually February 29th, so see you in 4 years. Like, sorry. And, like, and I would just tell him straight up, sorry, kid. Sucks for
that
you.
That would hurt.
Yeah. I'm going to try. I was going to say, I'm going to plan to have kids on leap year now. That was a great idea.
Well, do you obviously celebrate your birthday on March 1st then? Legally, if you go to the bars on February 28th and it's not a leap year, they can't let you in until March 1st. Legally. It could be...
I love how this always goes back to bars. It always arrives back at drinking. There's lots of other age implications right here, but we're talking drinking.
Because that's like the number one thing that's associated with turning 21 is you can legally walk into a bar, unless you're in Champaign on Green Street. You can legally walk in at 21 and have your first legal beverage. Or, and if you don't want to have a legal beverage, that's fine. totally acceptable. But you can at least walk into the establishment.
Fair enough.
Anyways, a basketball game was played last night. Speaking of leaping, the Illini men's basketball team leaped up a tad more in the Big Ten standings, not really. They got 5 Big Ten wins now. They swept the 2 worst teams in the Big Ten. They were the 3rd worst team, and then they got that Purdue upset, if you will, at State Farm Center. It was an interesting game yesterday. Was it really a... We got to ask Alex Roux when he comes in at 6:40, because if you read all the local coverage, including the Daily Illini, everybody is basically giving Whitman credit for turning that game around, because it was a stinker after one half, and then Whitman comes out during... The first half gives this hurrah type of speech, and all of a sudden it's a totally different basketball team in the second half. They absolutely dominated that second half. I only watched the second half. I was keeping up with the first half with my cellular device, and by the time I got home and turned it on, I had a feeling they were going to come back because there's a whole half. There's a whole 20 minutes of basketball left to play, but they totally dominated a 7-man Minnesota team who was out without 3 players, 1 being their leading scorer.
They only played 6.
I think they had 7. They played 6, but they had 7 active players. They could have played a 7th.
I don't even understand how you're losing to a team that has 6 players or is playing 6 players even for a half.
And their top guy's out.
And yeah, that's embarrassing.
Yeah, along with 2 other guys, obviously. But credit where credit's due, my friend. I mean, we would dog them had they lost. I don't know how much credit you give them. They ran away with it. I mean, Joey, you were there. Obviously, they were blowing the roof off the place, weren't they? And it was good enough for them. It was the last home game of the year. At least that Orange Crush crowd who's always there, they always want to cheer for something. They were finally given something to cheer about continuously, too, because once Illinois got momentum, boom, it was just play after play after play. You seen Orange Crush erupting.
And you have to be happy that Nunn and Hill played the game they did with 25 and 22 points, respectively. Your best players got to take care of a game like that, especially in the second half.
I know I'm supposed to have this wild, you know, wildly accurate wisdom on this game. I have no idea what the hell happened last night at State Farm Center. I mean, for how bad they played in that first half, I mean, I was sitting next to Rue and a couple other guys and was just like, what are we watching here? The defense was non-existent, and you're playing against a team, like you said.
Well, I'll ask you then, was it the Whitman effect?
I don't know if we could call it that, but, I mean, you know, Nate Mason, Dupree McBriar, and Kevin Dorsey all out for Minnesota that night for suspension reasons. Those are the top 3 scorers on that team. And it just was so weird that they just – and, you know, Richard Pitino, coach for Minnesota, kind of alluded to it that maybe once they found that out, they took their feet off the gas pedal a little bit if you're Illinois. But it was just like they didn't want to – be there. It was that last home game. It was slow. Nothing too much really going on. And that second half, boom, exploded. Defense shows up. It turns into offense. And you got a team that goes on a 40-18 run and outscores them. What was it? 54-31 in the final half. And it was just a nice showing for a team that hasn't really given you much. I'm not going to put too much on it, but it was at least a nice way to send out the seniors, which none of them played. Actually, Khalid Lewis played.
Wasn't that kind of weird? You have 3 seniors on senior night that you're honoring. Mike Thorne Jr., who basically didn't really play this year. He had, like, what, a little over a handful of games,
right,
transferred over. Khalid Lewis, who got here in, what was it, August, after Tracy Abrams went down again. And then you got Mike Latulip, who's choosing to ditch us after this year and go,
right,
get a transfer somewhere else. So the only guy who actually got to play on the floor was somebody who got here in August. And, that's just the situation they were dealt. But perhaps, I mean, I mentioned I kept up with the first half with my cellular device.
if a phone, for those of you playing at home.
Yes, my phone. Yes, let me be more conversational here on air, if I will, for all you listeners. So maybe what happened, what I would think, at least this would have been one of my questions, did the Illini really just underestimate this Minnesota team who was coming in down their leading scorer? You know, they're down three guys. They only played with six the whole game. Did Illinois maybe go in thinking it was in the bag, and then, whoa, first half ends, and then they said, you know what, okay, we really got to just settle down here. I mean, Probably. Possibly. Just playing down to their opponent?
If someone came up to you and said, by the way, your top three players are out, so you don't have to really worry about this game, you probably come out a little flatter, even though it's senior night. And two, all the seniors weren't playing. It's not like it was like this big it's not like if it was DJ Williams and Brandon Paul going on their final sundown. It was Thorne, who doesn't play, LaTulip, who they literally announced that the game was decided to opt out to transfer next year, basically, and then Clint Lewis, who really hasn't, you know, shown too much. Well, he did have mumps, so I guess that's a plus. But so it just was, it was a weird environment that turned to one of the best environments, at least this season, for Illinois. I mean, that was some of the loudest points and scores in terms of crowd reaction I've heard all year in State Farm Center. And that was, it was nice and fun, but I don't think we can put too much on it. It's still a win against a really bad Minnesota team.
I like the way Roux put it in his column. I may be misquoting, but I think he said sparse but raucous crowd, or yeah, sparse but noisy crowd, something like that. Because when you look at the pictures, it's like, wow, that place is empty. But they were really buzzed for the second half. But I also think, Dan, like, they did come out a little bit flat, Illinois, obviously. But Minnesota also nailed, wasn't it, 3 3-pointers in 3 possessions or like 4 possessions, something like that. So when you're shooting the ball that hot, that's tough. And then I just went to Figueroa's article, and it said that, where are the stats here? Yeah, Jordan Murphy had 17-8 in the first half alone.
Right.
And that's just Illinois' problem all year long, of not being able to defend big men. We talk about it all the time. It's a broken record, but still.
And look at DaMonte Williams on senior night just saying, hey, I'm going to Illinois. It had that same feel in the Illinois versus Northwestern game, football I'm talking now, obviously, when the Bill Cubitt extension kind of stole the show. It's here, it's senior night, then all of a sudden DaMonte, you know, oh, hey, I'm coming to Illinois, kind of stole the show a little bit. But, Joey, we were talking about it earlier. That's not till 2017.
Right.
So you're talking barring injury and like a Malcolm Hill redshirting or a Nunn redshirting. If they stay healthy, then no chance of playing with this guy. They'll be the seniors next year on senior night.
Right.
So it gives you a little bit of lift. You have some good recruits coming in. He is a 4-star. Obviously, his daddy playing here has something to do with that, you would think. Illinois probably has no chance if he doesn't have that Illinois connection. Granted, he does. And the kid's coming here. At least that's what he's committed to. But, right, unless he changes his mind, I don't see that happening, most likely because he has those ties. So kind of sold the show a little bit last night. And at least looking forward until 2017, you have that popsicle house is getting built up a little more and more and more. I don't know what else you're going to recruit there, but you're starting with something.
It's a huge start, and it might give Gross another year, because just the possibility of what he could be will be so, I don't know, interesting and intriguing to Josh Whitman and the rest of the athletic staff. They might keep him around just to see what he can do with a big-time recruit.
Well, if you let Gross go, even if it's this year, DaMonte might change his mind. Who knows? I doubt it, but technically he's a Gross recruit, so if you get rid of his coach, that's part of the reason he's coming here, because he wants to play for John Gross. At least you would hope he wants to play for Gross, so that he's not just coming here because he has some kind of connection to the university. So, yeah, it's a good point. Gross has a couple recruits now coming in for 2017, and we could talk to Roux about that later. But if you let Gross go, then what happens with these recruits?
And sometimes the chips start to fall when, you know, you do get that first big-time recruit, because then his buddy from AAU wants to come and play with him, or just the fact of, hey, they just know this kid's a big-time player, the possibility of, you know, making a Final Four or a national title or something like that. So hopefully he can attract more big-time recruits. We'll see.
It's a weird spot. I know we'll get to it. We'll talk more basketball 6:40, but before we break, it's a weird spot because all year we've been trying to figure out if Gross is staying or going, and we critique his coaching, you critique the different recruit things. You can't really control injury. But with this recruit, it's like almost an idea of, oh, well, of course now he's back because he secured this guy. And then you look down the road, and Tijon Lucas obviously injured, but another big guy you're bringing in the fold. LaRon Black could have been, and it depends on how they treat the situation. But there's these weird glimpses of hope that keep allowing Illini Nation to circle back around and go, oh, wait, this guy can keep his job. And as bad as the on-court product may be, that hope is still there. And we've heard that from a couple of people just before the show today. And it's just, it's an interesting take because we call for someone's head, not us, but, you know, a lot of Illini fans maybe call for John Gross's head only to then turn around last night and go, oh, now he's got this four-star recruit that's coming on.
People spring on to hope. Hope keeps things interesting.
Thank you. That's coming from a Sox fan. Usually that's a Cub fan would have that idea.
That was poetic.
Very. Let's take a quick break here. When we come back, shifting gears, we're talking hockey. Eric Cruickshank and Austin Zima jumping on with us to preview their next matchup here as they are well underway in tournament play for their season. 640, Alex Roux jumping on to talk to DaMonte Williams in Illini basketball. This is Illini Drive on Champaign's Alternative WPGU 107.1.
Hey, it's Dave Edit from WGN Sports in Chicago, and you're listening to Illini Drive on WPGU.
And producer man Jeff Omer laying down some sweet beats right there. That's what I like to see, but welcome back into Illini Drive. Kevin McCarthy here alongside Dan Collins, Joey Gelman, and Jeff Omer. You guys are used to hearing Joey bring us back, but today he let me have the honor because we only have two microphones. It's actually why, not because I deserved it. But now we have Austin Zima and Eric Cruickshank from the Illini hockey team joining the show. They've got a very big tournament this weekend, the end of their season with the national tournament. It starts Thursday for them against the Syracuse Orange, and those games will take place in Bensonville, Illinois. So they're looking forward to that. But for right now, gentlemen, how you doing?
I'm doing good. How are you?
Yeah, good. And you guys had, before we get to talking about the ACHA tournament, you guys had senior weekend, or senior night on, I guess it was senior weekend, Friday and Saturday night, playing against Indiana Tech. Two nice wins for you guys. I know they weren't conference games or anything like that, but what were your guys' big takeaways on senior night?
I think it's obviously great to get two wins and get a sweep on the weekend against a team like that and to be able to send our seniors out with a good memory of their last two games here at the Big Pond. But I think it's a good atmosphere. Everyone's having a good time. There's a lot of laughs, a lot of good memories, a lot of reminiscing on 4 years or however many years they played. I know a couple of them didn't play the whole 4 years, but it's a great weekend. It's fun and we enjoy it, and it's good to get the two wins, like I said, to send them out.
Yeah, and Austin, five seniors on that team, probably most notably John Olin, who coached Fabrini before the game, said is one of the best guys to ever wear the blue and orange sweater. So for you, seeing all five of those guys go, and specifically Johnny Olin, was there any extra sentimental value on watching them play their last game at home?
Well, you know, all five of those guys are great people on and off the ice, both in the locker room and in the game, and specifically Johnny O. I'd have to say when you lose your captain, especially someone who's worn a letter for, I think, 3 years that he did as an Illini, that's a big turning point in an organization. We're really going to miss him, and we're going to miss the talents of all five of those other guys next year, too. But like I said, when you graduate a captain, especially someone that's worn a letter for 3 years, it's a big time in an organization because new leadership starts to form, and new leadership will start to form in this national tournament as we kind of head into the closing part of our season.
Yeah, and I actually had the luxury of being there Saturday night, part of the broadcast team with Kevin, and that first period was electric. All five seniors getting on the board. You have Varzino finding Twine, and you have Olin and Pacheco getting an assist, and Yoshi finds the back of the net. Did you guys notice that going into that first period intermission that all five seniors end up getting at least 1 point in that first period?
Yeah, I mean, it's always something very noticeable when Yoshi actually scores a goal. So, but no, it was great. It was great to see those guys just buzzing pretty much that whole game. All five of them played really well. And I noticed a lot Fabble putting the seniors out there consistently, especially when we started to get guys injured and whatnot. But just being able to see those guys come out and finish out hard just gives everyone like a little bit of motivation to say, like, these guys have played here for 4 years and this is their last game here. And you can see that they're really like, they were excited and they really like took it in, I guess, is the best way to put it.
And so you mentioned Yoshi's goal and you laughed about it. We got to talk about that for a second. After the game, well, actually throughout the game, the crowd was going nuts for Yosh. And then after the game was over, he skates over and salutes them. They're cheering his name, going crazy. What's the deal with the fans and Yoshi Shibata?
I honestly, I've only seen it for 2 years, so I'm not exactly sure. He's a fan favorite, I guess. That's the best way to put it. Ever since I came here, every game he started or done anything, they always get the Yoshi chant going, and they've had the Japanese flag hanging down. And he's just been a guy that I think the Harassing Illini has loved ever since he transferred here.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, now talking about this week in practice, Austin, how about for you? What have been some of the big, or I don't know if you guys practiced today or not, but what will be some of the big teaching points for Fabo as you guys get ready for Thursday's game against Syracuse?
In preparation for this weekend, you know, coach has been stressing light but smart. We're not going to do anything to really wear out our legs, but we're also not going to do anything to, like, to give our minds a break. People can fall into the trap of, you know, kind of letting off the foot before you hit a tournament time like this, or letting off the gas pedal, excuse me. But we can't afford to do that. We need to rest our bodies. We need to get our minds right. But we also have to make sure that we're constantly, you know, prepping for things we're going to need, whether that's defense, offense, neutral zone attacks, all that kind of stuff, while at the same time not overexerting ourselves so, you know, everybody's healthy and ready to go when the puck drops on Thursday.
And what's the attitude like going into a one-and-done national tournament? So how what's the emotion, the feeling, as you know that this could be your last 60 minutes of hockey for the entire year?
Well, emotions are definitely riding high in a good way. Coming off a senior weekend sweep helps that for sure. And it's always great when you can have a senior like Johnny O, who wears a C, you know, be the captain, literally, of those emotions across the whole team. He's a silent leader, but, you know, his play really sparks the guys and also sparks the attitudes. And then leadership across the board, not only me and Crooks, but, you know, our juniors, our sophomores, and even some of our freshmen have stepped up really big. So emotions 1 through 30 in the locker room, they are where they need to be, which is always a positive thing. You know, you just want to keep – you got a team riding high, sitting on the high horse going into Syracuse, and that's what we did after two big wins.
And with that tournament style, like Kevin mentioned, for you guys, you know, it's similar to, you know, an NCAA basketball kind of style where you're one and done. But usually when we think of hockey, at least professionally, it's those, you know, best of seven series that are amazing and fun and really long. So I guess for you guys, even though it's the prospect of obviously, you know, surviving in advance is kind of fun, would you prefer a longer series to get to know a team, or just based on the nature of how your season's gone, they're really kind of quick series for you guys all year? It's kind of what you're used to.
Yeah, I think the thing about obviously the national tournament is it's a one weekend thing. So obviously there's clearly not enough time to be able to play two or three, four games against those teams. But from a standpoint of just going in and playing a team once and not having to play them again, it can kind of suck, but it can also be good at the same time, because if we don't come to play one game, that's all you got. You don't have a second chance to come back and beat that team again. But I think we've gotten used to just playing teams we've never seen before. And I think if we just play our game instead of playing into their style, I think we'll be fine.
And I want to ask this question for the defenseman here. So, Austin, obviously in hockey, in a tournament style format, a hot goaltender means a lot. You look at the Kings a few years ago, an 8th seed, Jonathan Quick gets hot, whole team gets hot, they win a Stanley Cup. Having a goaltender like Joe Olin, who was just named MVP of the CSCHL, how much confidence do you guys have knowing that you've got one of the best in the nation between the pipes for the tournament?
The cool thing about Joe is that he's not a goaltender that we have to worry about getting hot, because he's just flat out good. He'll stop a puck on his coldest nights, and he'll stop more pucks on his hottest ones, like you just said. But like I said earlier in this statement, he's good. He's a good goalie in all the facets of his game, and that gives us a lot of confidence, especially going into a game in which a bad bounce could be the end of your season, because you don't get that second or that third night, like Crooksy said, to battle back and make up for that bad luck. So having a goalie between the pipes that you know is going to make the easy one and the hard one, no matter if it's his off night or, you know, his hottest of nights, is a very big confidence boost.
And so for our listeners who don't know, the last time that Illinois hockey raised a banner was 2008. Coach Fabrini, who coaches the team now, is actually on that team. I think they were undefeated, as he likes to tell you guys all the time. Oh, yeah. I know he talks about it all the time,
and
you guys answer questions about it all the time. But that was the last time that Illinois won a national title. That ACHA banner is hanging up in the rink. How does that help Coach Fabrini coach you guys on a week like this? And then in the actual game itself, I mean, once the tournament starts, how does his experience with that tournament help him?
I think we've talked about this before with just his his ability to have that experience behind him, and he's physically been there as a player, so he knows what's going through our heads as well as him now coaching us. So just being able to have him just be able to kind of walk us through game by game, shift by shift, the national tournament, because he's been there, he's done it, is just an awesome, I guess, attribute to have for our program. Not a lot of coaches in this league have ever won a national championship in the ACHA. So it's almost like a treat for us to have him as a coach that has won a national championship twice and done it at the ACHA level.
And this question might be a little bit more suited for Zima, but we talked about this a little bit on Saturday. It just seems like Illini hockey, at least the past decade or so, just breeds goaltenders. You know, Joey O's been solid his whole career here. Heflin comes out this weekend, has a pretty good series. What is it? Is it just you guys are getting lucky with these guys? Is it work that they're doing with assistant coach O'Brien? Or what exactly is it? What kind of work do they put in there?
First and foremost, I think a lot of it does have to do with Tommy O'Brien on the bench, even though he won't admit it. He's a very humble guy. But with his experience playing Division I hockey at Notre Dame, that really transfers over into the minds of our goaltenders. And then to address your question, you know, to be honest, I don't have an answer for that. We do attract good goalies. They seem to come out of the woodwork and put on our sweaters, which is always a good thing. And we're not going to argue or, you know, be salty at that because it helps us win games. So if they keep coming, we'll keep playing for them. But it's like you guys said, it's a blessing to have goaltenders like this. You know, Heflin, Joe, and Zev are all three goaltenders that could contend for a top spot in the league, in our opinion. And I think other teams have seen them prove that. So whatever it is that keeps bringing good goalies to U of I, we've really benefited from that.
And I'm sure you guys don't want to answer this question, but it is an interesting one. You two both wear the A's. You'll both be on the team next year. The senior captain, Johnny Olin, is graduating. Have you guys thought about that at all? Has Coach talked about who will get the C next year? Or would you guys like to say anything on that? As you dodge, they're pointing at each other. Neither of them want to answer, it looks like.
I think realistically, obviously we're losing a captain. That means there's going to have to be a new one next year. Whether it's one of us two or even someone else, we haven't really gotten into that topic at all. I don't think it's really been a worry because I know there's plenty of guys that can step up and either take that C role or take an A role from one of us two. But at the end of the day, like, it doesn't matter if you have an A or a C on your sweater. I know regardless of what happens, me and him are both going to be leaders on this team. So going off that, like, it's just a thing where we know that we're both going to be leaders for the duration of our careers here. And whether that means you have an A on your jersey, a C on your jersey, or you don't have any letter in your jersey, we're both going to still be leaders on this team.
Go a little easier on you guys, but I'm going to stick down the same type of road. Shibata is leaving as well. Who's going to be the new fan favorite for the Harassing Illini?
You got anybody in mind? Well, let's throw it to you guys. Who do you guys think will be the next fan favorite? You're the ones that watch the games from the stands and in the penalty boxes. You hear all the murmurs. What do you guys think?
I mean, I think if people were down there on the bench and could hear some of the things that happened, they might feel differently about certain players. Because, you know, I'm not going to say any names, but I think if they knew Eric Salters a little better and the way he chirps, I think that they would love that because he belongs up in the stands with them at times. Yeah. But I mean, I'll also say Chris Loznak. Why isn't he a fan favorite? He's hard not to love, you know? So yeah. They should be Lozy fans in my
opinion. I agree with that. You know, Lozy is kind of a pretty boy on the team. He's more worried about his hair sometimes than other things. But
it's some ugly hair, though, I will say. Like, I can't use that word on air.
It doesn't suit him well. I see what you're saying.
Yeah,
but
absolutely.
You know, to be honest, this is just a fun team to be around. So I'm sure somebody will win over the hearts of the Harassing Illini up there in the near future. I'm not really too worried about that.
Any chance it's either one of you guys?
Probably not. Probably not me. I'm gonna be realistic. Probably not me.
They fall in love with Eric Cruickshank's slap shot. No doubt about that.
Yeah.
I don't know about anything else other than that. Any final words of wisdom before we go? Is it about time for break? I don't even know. Yes, you're Joey Shank. Am I supposed to close this? All right, well, thanks a bunch to Eric Cruickshank and Austin Zima, two guys who wear A's on their jerseys. But they're number one in our hearts. That doesn't really work. That's a letter and a number, but still, regardless. Good luck to both of you guys this weekend as you take on Syracuse Thursday for the ACHA tournament.
Yep, thanks for having us, guys.
Yeah, so hopefully Eric Cruickshank, Austin Zima, and the rest of the Illini hockey team can try to hang the first national championship banner since 2008. Keep it tuned right here on Illini Drive. We'll be back in just a couple minutes.
Hey, it's Dave Edit from WGN Sports in Chicago, and you're listening to Illini Drive on WPGU.
Welcome back into Illini Drive, your home on the way home for Illini Sports every Monday at 6. Joey Gellman, Jeff Omer, Dan Collins, Kevin McCarthy. UPTV is here. They re-air us Wednesdays, 9 p.m. Urbana Public Television. At Illini Drive at @D_sports for the Twitter handles. Our thanks to Eric Cruickshank and Austin Zima for jumping on. As we mentioned, they play Thursday against Syracuse in their tournament game. It's a one-and-done style tourney, so could potentially be their last, or they survive in advance and keep going. We'll have to wait and see. Our thanks to them. Alex Roux is going to jump on in around 10 minutes or so with us. He's running a little late, so that's going to be closer to 6:45. He's going to jump on, talk to DaMonte Williams and Illini basketball. And looking at Illini basketball, Roux and I were on the floor yesterday by Minnesota's coach, Richard Pitino. And it's just interesting to see because, obviously, in the shadow, his dad, Rick, and, you know, the fun things going on at Louisville and all the allegations they are having fun to have. And, boy, oh, boy, was Orange Crush just railing on him last night. I mean, it was just too easy. Even the ushers were laughing and, like, kudosing the Orange Crush members who were all dressed in, like, sumo suits and craziness for the last home game.
I must ask, and we might get a little bit of dead air here as you think about your thoughts. Anything that you could mention on radio, anything that you heard that was just really good, I mean, they would probably let him have it all game.
I mean, there was some stuff about wins. It was like, oh, don't worry, you're only like 700 wins behind your dad. But then it got into like the other stuff of like, hey, like, you know, Rick must know a lot of girls for you. And like different things like that. It was perfect. It was probably worse and I can't, you know, repeat them. But it was just, everything you could think of about that scenario at Louisville, just pouring it on his son.
Well, you got to think about it. We mentioned this earlier, Orange Crush. They've been wanting things to cheer about all year.
Yeah.
And whenever something little comes up, they do. And kudos to them. So when you have a Minnesota Golden Gophers team going in there, they're obviously the inferior team. Pitino and what's going on with Pops over there in Louisville, obviously now you could throw that on them. You're the team who's most likely going to get the win. And as soon as Illinois starts handing them the business in the second half, it's almost like the pot boiled over. Like Orange Crush is on the stove this whole year, and it was just ready to boil over. And Pitino and the Golden Gophers were exactly just what set it up.
And because they had to shut up against Indiana because ESPN was getting at them for being too rowdy behind Dan Dockich, which is always something I would like to see, is making fun of Dan Dockich, you know, fighting with our former mayor, John Girard. But, yeah, I mean, they weren't allowed to do half the stuff they wanted to do last week. They didn't even play one of the songs, I think. But then this week they let it rip.
I mean, I always love Orange Crush, and they are awesome. But it's classless, in my opinion, to go after a dude for what his dad has done, or for what his dad has allegedly done. Now, his dad, it is confirmed that he cheated on his wife, so the Minnesota's coach, what's his name?
Richard. Little Richie.
Little Richie's mom. So, I mean, okay, but why are you attacking him for that? And then everything going on right now at Louisville, it's all alleged. We don't know for sure. Why are you putting that on the kid?
It was just funny because...
Come on, Orange Crush.
It was just funny because the whole thing was that before the game, these three players got suspended. And they go, well, what's the problem with the suspension? He wouldn't answer because no coach will ever answer. But it's the idea of, we have a culture we're building here and we have to stick to this culture and build and make it a great thing. And it's in the back of your mind, you're like, we know what your dad did at Louisville or what he's alleged to doing. And you're preaching culture to the media. It was just so funny.
Kevin, when you're at the Illini hockey games, you are directly underneath that harassing Illini. That fan base literally does research on anything they can, not even necessarily with the player. They'll research your families if they can. They will throw everything and the kitchen sink at you. I am shocked you think that is a little too much.
It's different with Illini hockey because Illini hockey is a club sport, and this is Big Ten basketball, I don't know. It's hard to say. But That's a good point. But hockey is such a different sport. Everyone is ruthless in general. And most of the attacks that those harassing Illini are making, while they are horrible, they are personal attacks on the actual players on the ice, whereas this is going after a dude's dad.
Aren't most attacks, like, pretty personal? What's it, little Richie, little Dickie? I don't know, whatever it is. Is it? I mean, aren't all attacks pretty personal to some degree?
Yeah, but what did our caller just say? That's my question.
You said that Orange Crush is for Syracuse, not
Orange Crush. No, the,
no,
orange,
the
crush
orange Crush is no, the Illinois.
The Orange Crush is for the University of Illinois, my friend.
I'm sorry. First,
how do we have a Champaign Urbana caller saying the Orange Crush is for Syracuse?
You know, I love that we have that someone's calling because
yes,
that means someone's listening. And please call us more in the future. We love when people call. But here's what I'll say. I'm sorry. You're wrong. Orange Crush, U of I, Google it, dude. It's all over the place. You can't go 10 minutes on campus without somebody with one of those stupid Orange Crush shirts in your face. And when you're at the game, how do you not see the 1,500 fans painted, you know, with their entire bodies? They look like the Blue Men Group, except in orange. Yes, Orange Crush.
Well, what joke would you have thrown at him then? Do you have anything in your back pocket?
I'm not. I can't.
That wouldn't have been too personal. Kevin, you're good on the spot. Do you read this kid's columns? You could write jokes galore. I know you would have had something for Pitino.
I would have made fun of Rick Pitino for the crap that's happening there. Okay. But his son, maybe I'd mock him for his shoes or his hair or something like that he is doing wrong. I'm not going to, or mock him for the fact that he only has seven players dressed, because that's silly.
Really?
But I would not mock him for the fact that his dad is having, you know, all this huge scandal around him, because I feel horrible for his dad right now.
But mocking the fact that he had to suspend three players is fair game.
Oh, absolutely. Because that's him, not his dad. Right now, his dad just got a tournament ban for something that we're not even sure what actually happened yet. The facts aren't even out, but his team can't go to, you know, a postseason. That's rough. Now, I'm not saying I feel that bad for him. I mean, the dude makes $5 million a year. His life could be significantly worse. I realize, you know, this is a small
problem.
That's
less than we get paid.
Yes, more than I make in a week. It's a small problem relative to those of the world. But, I mean, come on. You got to feel bad for the guy. We don't even know. Like, it's just not, why are you doing this to his kid is my point. That's classless.
I mean, I guess the main reason I'll agree. Okay, what if it wasn't alleged? What if it was proven? Which it wasn't.
It's still
it's alleged.
Dad. It's his dad. What does his kid have
to do with
that?
What if it's proven, though? What if it's proven?
Why are you making fun of the kid for that?
Because it's funny. Like I said, I'll give you this one because nothing's been proven. It's just alleged.
So in this upcoming presidential election, are you going to say, oh, hey, Hillary Clinton, remember when your husband cheated on you when you guys were in the White House?
Do you not see what Trump has been doing to Jeb before Jeb knocked himself out?
Okay, so we're going to make Donald Trump our moral standard now.
No.
We're going to make Donald Trump, that's how we decide what is right and what is wrong.
I'll
Donald
get
you a line
Trump. I drive. You're home for steep and low on the way.
Goodness gracious. What? How do we even get here? Oh, classless Orange Crush fans.
Yeah. Well, and just, I don't know, Richard, I mean, I can't judge. I shouldn't judge people like, you know, don't judge a book by its cover. But he just looks like that, like, snotty coach's kid that just is there because dad coaches.
Yeah, you know who he reminds me of for some reason? I can't really explain why, is Mike Thomas. He's got that look, like that mug only a mother could love. You know what I mean? Like, you just look at his face and you're like, you're kind of slimy. But so is Rick Pitino. Rick Pitino's real slimy looking.
Which, by the way, loved, you know, speaking of Mike Thomas, I don't think he would have done something like Whitman did yesterday, like that halftime speech.
Well,
but
he can't do that kind of thing because he doesn't have the orange and blue running through his blood.
That's true. And by the way, to our caller, Otto's Army is the Syracuse student section. Otto's Army is the student section. So for Orange Crush fans out there worrying that we're replacing your student section, it's not the case. It's still Orange Crush.
Thank you for the call from the listener.
Yeah, thank you, though. Keep listening. We do like you. And I don't mean like to berate you like a mean sports show host.
Should we give him a name moving forward as our lone caller?
Otto.
Otto?
Otto, O-T-T-O?
Yeah.
It was a man. Are we sure of that? Okay.
Yes.
So Otto. Uncle Otto. Let's call him Uncle Otto.
Deal.
Thanks for the call, Uncle Otto.
Oh, we love our fans.
Is it time for us to go for a while?
It is. Let's take a break here. We're going to come back. Alex Roux jumping on. He's the Illini men's basketball columnist. So he's going to jump on, talk Illinois men's basketball and DaMonte Williams signing and committing to the Illinois Fighting Illini. It's Illini Drive on Champaign's Alternative WPGU 107.1.
This is Stephen Bardo. If you want all the latest and greatest in sports, check out the Illini Draft, WPGU 107.1.
Welcome into Illini Drive, your home on the way home for Illini Sports every Monday at 6. Joey Gelman, Jeff Fomer, Dan Collins, Kevin McCarthy, UPTV. We're all here. Hope you are as well. Where'd you find the Bardo one? I'm impressed. We've been looking for those for the whole year. I love when we find things lost in a computer. It's always a glorious day. So if you see my fist pump on the re-air, it's because I love Urbana Public Television and because we found Stephen Bardo's show bump, which hopefully will be followed by Jimmy Jackson, Will Leach, but we'll take it slowly but surely. We'll get there. Joining us now in studio, he is Alex Roux, the Daily Illini's men's basketball columnist. Joins us now to talk the game last night, and DaMonte Williams. Alex, how are you?
I'm good. Good to be back. We got some good news. I think everyone can agree it was a good day of Illini basketball yesterday. So,
a rare sighting. No arrests, just happiness.
We're just about at 24 hours since the DaMonte Williams commitment, and no one's got arrested yet. So that's good.
Give it time. So just starting off with last night's game, I know we kind of talked about it throughout while we were there. What a strange game. I mean, that first half was almost unwatchable. And the second half, I remember you turning to me and going, what are we watching? What just happened? The team turned it on.
Yeah, it was crazy. I mean, it looked like no one really wanted to be there in the first half. It was just a really weird pace for Illinois. They didn't look particularly interested in playing defense. And Minnesota, with pretty much their whole backcourt suspended and not playing, kind of got to the rim at ease with Jordan Murphy. And I guess Illinois figured it out at the halftime break while Josh Whitman was giving us our speech out at midcourt. And they came out and looked like a completely different team after the break. So they pulled it out.
And you notice what changed? I mean, you know, defensively was obviously the spark plug for the offense. But what changed defensively? Was it just a matter of playing? Or was there something schematically? Because I don't know, I may have just missed what they were playing. But in terms of just because the defense just didn't even seem like they were there in the first half, let alone the offense showing up. But script flipped real quick.
Well, it looked like they finally realized that Minnesota has a walk-on playing point guard right now. And,
yeah.
Hey, let's take the ball from him and get out and transition a little bit. And Gross said, he told his guys at halftime, hey, you guys figure this out. I'll give you a little extra time to figure it out. And it looked like Hill and Nunn kind of led the defensive turnaround and got out in transition, got some layups, a couple dunks, and got the crowd into it. So I don't think it was anything really schematically that changed. It just looked like they wanted to be there in the second half, which – at this point in the season, it's a little troubling that even has to be an issue, that they need to show up pretty much. But they showed up, and they got it done, and it wasn't really even close in the second half.
And, Roux, we're going to talk DaMonte Williams and recruit talk in a little bit, but you've seen many, at least I would assume, you've seen many a senior nights here in Champaign, whether it be on television, in the stands, on press row. Was it a little – did you have a little different feeling watching senior night yesterday? You got Mike Thorne Jr., who hasn't really played much. You got Khalid Lewis, who got here, in August when Abrams went down. You have Mike LaTulip, who's telling the team bye at the end of this and transferring over. Did the senior night not have that big of a feel as it usually does in seasons past?
Yeah, I mean, it was kind of fitting for the season, honestly, that started out in Springfield and never really got off on a good foot at all, that the senior night was a little strange. The only guy that's played a game this year on State Farm Center's floor was Khalid Lewis, and he's a guy you can't really get attached to because it's his third school, and he hasn't done a whole lot here. I mean, obviously, appreciate him coming in and doing what he can, but it's not really getting worked up like you would last year with the hometown guy, Ravonte Rice, and Nana Egwu, who'd been here all 4 years. So, yeah, it was a little strange. I mean, not really emotionally tear-jerking at all or anything like that, so... it was just kind of something that happened before the game, and we moved on and we played.
Poor kid transfers here for 1 year, tries to give us some point guard help, and gets the mumps as soon as he gets to campus. That's ridiculous. Okay, so DaMonte Williams, we talked about this a little earlier in the show. Obviously, four-star recruit doesn't come to 2017. Does that maybe help Gross's? Does that hot seat get a little colder now for Gross because you let him go? Let's just say if you were to do it, theoretically speaking, at the end of this year, that's one of his recruits coming in. Does that maybe change the mind of a DaMonte Williams? Does this make his job a touch more secure now?
Yeah, well, you got to keep in mind that next year is Gross's make or break year no matter what. And DaMonte Williams, regardless, isn't coming until after next year. But it still legitimizes what Gross is trying to do here. I mean, it definitely cools his seat, I think, in the eyes of fans. I don't think Josh Whitman was getting rid of Gross anyway. Gross said he gave Josh Whitman a big hug after the game yesterday. That doesn't sound like someone who's getting ready to fire anybody at this point, especially since Whitman's not starting until after Illinois' season is conceivably over in mid-March here. So I don't think Gross is going anywhere regardless, and now I think it kind of legitimizes Gross's efforts a little bit here to try and land a really good class in 2017 and maybe get a guy like Jordan Goodwin from Belleville or Jeremiah Tillman, who was originally from the St. Louis area, and now he's playing up in Indiana. in prep school, but it legitimizes those efforts and kind of gives them a little leverage now that, hey, I got this new class coming in. If next year, if they make the tournament in convincing fashion, you still have a possibly a really good class coming in 2017.
And, Roux, for our listeners who maybe don't watch a ton of high school basketball or don't follow that scene closely, can you just talk a little bit about what type of player DaMonte Williams is on the court? What could he bring to Illinois? And when he does finally lace up, you know, lace him up for the blue and orange, will he, I should say orange and blue, that sounded bad, in 2017, can he be the type of player that has an immediate impact as a freshman?
Well, yeah, ESPN has him rated as a top 40 player, and when you get a top 40 player, they're usually guys that can come in and contribute right away. He's not a pure point guard. I know some sites he's listed as a point guard, some he's listed as a shooting guard. He's really a guy that can just do it all on offense and attack and penetrate. I haven't seen him play in person yet, but what I've seen, obviously everyone looks good on YouTube and everything like that, but he looks like a guy that can score, and if he's anything like his dad, Frank Williams, who played in the early 2000s and was a Big Ten player of the year in 2001, Illinois should be getting a special player. And if he lives up to that ranking, anywhere close to a top 40 player, I think he'll be a really good player for 4 years.
I know it might be a little hard to foresee now, but you lose a Nunn and Hill after next season. You have Tajon coming in next year. Then you got Pickett and you got Williams for 2017. Right. Are these guys, and like I said, it might be a little hard to foresee now, but are they going to have to contribute as soon as they get here with the guys you have leaving within the next couple of years? And what you have now, your freshman and sophomore base, might not be blowing your socks off. So are these guys, the Lucases, the Williams, the Picketts, are they going to have to come in and start contributing immediately?
Yeah, well, by that time, you kind of hope that Aaron Jordan and DJ Williams have kind of filled in those roles. And
JCL.
And JCL, yeah, and Coleman Lands, of course, on the wings. So I don't think you're going to throw these guys into the fire by any means. You're not going to be relying too heavily, hopefully, on freshmen at that point to come in and contribute if you have Coleman Lands and Aaron Jordan developing as they should. That it gets more dicey when you look at the big man situation. Maverick Morgan will be gone after that year. Finke is really the only big man for sure on the roster right now with Laron Black and kind of the hot water that he's in. So that's when it gets crucial and critical that you get a guy like Jeremiah Tillman, a big man who Illinois is not accustomed to getting, a guy that is ranked top 15, top 10 in the entire country. So, yeah, if you don't get, I mean, Jeremiah Tillman obviously would be great. If you don't get another capable big in that class to kind of hold down that front line, you're looking at a pretty thin roster, or a pretty incomplete roster, I would say, going past next season when you got Hill, Nunn, Morgan, guys like that graduating.
And we talk about kind of building this team here, and I guess for Illinois fans, and I guess just college basketball in general, do we kind of hold some of these coaches to too high of a standard? I mean, yesterday at the game when they introduced Gross, it was almost crickets in there in terms of like just how he's received by the fans, his reception, but received by the fans. And so, you know, we talked about this with Tim Beckman too, and, you know, for him, was his stint a large enough sample size? Is 4 years for Gross a large enough sample size? Because there's that demand to win when really, you know, in normal circumstances, or maybe 10 years ago, he could have stayed 7 years, and then that's the sample size of, okay, he couldn't get it done. Because really, he's only had one recruiting class come through. So I guess the question becomes, you know, we've talked about him being safe or not being safe, but I guess it's something to kind of look at in terms of, okay, how hot is that seat because there's that demand to win? But then, wait a minute, is he building something here that we just, you know, unfortunately didn't see through the first recruiting class? Maybe they set the building block for that second recruiting class. But by the time that group would graduate, that's 8 years from that first year. It's a long time. It's just, it's a demand.
Yeah, I think after 4 years, it's absolutely fair to look at Gross and what he's done here. And it's gotten pretty much worse every year. Mm-hmm. And for a guy like Gross, who came in and sort of projected almost instant success, he had a very good first year with Bruce Weber's players and was immediately on the recruiting trail, recruiting high-profile players. I think he kind of raised his own expectations a little bit, and now it's coming back to bite him a little bit now when fans are waiting and the results aren't there. So I think it's absolutely fair to evaluate Gross, but then again, I think he kind of weathered the storm this year a little bit. It doesn't look like Whitman's going to make a move here, and getting Williams helps his case even more. But I think it's absolutely fair for fans to be restless and for fans to expect better. And three straight NCAA tournament drought, 3 years without NCAA tournament, it's looking like here, it's almost unprecedented. So To answer your question, I think fans are absolutely justified in getting restless and still expecting more even after DaMonte Williams committed. I think they're fair to expect even bigger class in 2017.
Talking with Alex Roux here, Daily Illini men's basketball columnist, and going back to Williams, is he the kind of guard that Gross has been looking for? Because all we've heard for 4 years is Gross's offense runs through his kind of point guard. Is he that guy?
Well, I think Gross is hoping and planning on Tijon Lucas really being that primary point guard and being and having DaMonte Williams be more of a scoring threat off the dribble that can attack and kind of do it all on offense. So I don't think he's going to be the playmaker, primary playmaker that the offense runs through bringing up the ball at the floor. I think that the plan is for that to be Tijon Lucas if he can stay healthy. Yeah. I don't know. He's still a junior in high school, so we have to see what he evolves into. I mean, people were saying...
But he looks like... He has, like, the Greg Oden effect. He looks like he's about 40.
Yeah, he does. he looks legit. And, people were saying Jalen Coleman-Lands might come in and be a point guard, and obviously that hasn't materialized like some people might have hoped. But, yeah, I mean, if he can be a consistent threat to score at two, if you bring these pieces in around him and Tijon Lucas can play well at the point and bring in Jordan Goodwin and have Javon Pickett, the other guy in the 2017 class, be an effective player at the tail end of Aaron Jordan and Jalen Coleman-Land's career, then you might have something there.
And what about his size? 6'3", 180 right now. You mentioned that he's just a junior, so you'd have to imagine that, you know, in a couple of years and once he gets on that college lifting and eating program, he could be, you know, a pretty big dude. What kind of benefit will that have to his game, and how have you seen him in the highlights you have seen? How does he use that size to his advantage?
Definitely. What I've heard and what it looks like is that he already has kind of a really good frame for college basketball, that he should be able to put on good weight fairly easily, and he already is a pretty physical player, so I think that'll certainly help him out once he gets to this level, and his learning curve and his adjustment might not be as big as for, I guess, someone who's not built as well as he is with that size of 6'3". I think one thing that is certainly worth mentioning is that DaMonte Williams is close with Jeremiah Tillman, and those guys do talk, and they do talk about, and it's not just internet message board rumors, they do talk about playing together in Illinois, and if that's something that has significance with Tillman, and he really buys into building something here, then... I mean, maybe a commitment from Tillman's not too far away. I mean, I've heard encouraging things on Tillman that he was really, really sat well with him, that Williams committed here yesterday, and it kind of legitimized it for him. So you never know. I mean, if Gross lands Tillman, that would really legitimize what he's trying to build here. And even though it's maybe a couple of years later than what fans thought when they were looking at Cliff Alexander and Jalen Brunson and Juwan Evans, I think they would gladly trade that in a couple of bad years in for a monster recruiting class like everyone hopes.
Alex, we really appreciate the time. Thanks for jumping on, and we look forward to checking in with you the rest of the way.
Thanks, guys. Good to see recruiting heating up a little bit again.
How about that? Finally, some positive news for Illini Athletics. That's going to do it for us here today on Illini Drive. Our thanks to Eric Cruickshank and Austin Zima jumping on Illini Hockey. Alex Roux, who you just heard breaking down Illini men's basketball, and the DaMonte Williams committing to Illinois last night. Can you call it a signing? Because they're not really... Commitment, I guess. I always think of signing, but then it seems like they're getting paid. And we all know college athletes not getting paid.
Never.
What about college broadcasters? Do we get paid? I can't remember.
Debatable.
Yeah.
We'll have to ask the higher-ups.
Yeah, let me go ask the boss who I don't have about that paycheck that I don't receive.
No.
Dan's wallet is empty, so I guess the answer to that is unfortunately no. So for Jeff Omer, Dan Collins, Kevin McCarthy, I'm Joey Gellman. A reminder, UPTV will re-air us Wednesday at 9 p.m. You can catch all this action live and see our beautiful faces. I don't think our beards are as bad as they used to be.
Mine's actually coming in, I think.
Yeah, it looks nice.
Thank you.
You're very lumberjacky today.
Yeah, I know. The flannel plus the wannabe beard. Yeah. If I didn't have this, like, pretty boy haircut, then it would be better.
And then we'll put all this stuff on dailyillini.com for you to catch the podcast, the two interviews we did today with the hockey guys and Alex Roux. So we will be back with you next Monday. Sportscasts are all this week like normal, 6:30 to 7 p.m. Tuesday through Friday. Once again, this is your home on the way home for Illini Sports and Champaign's alternative WPGU 107.1.